evening out there, and welcome to the Laughing Monkey Music Show. How are you doing today, man?
Great, great, great. Good to see you. Thanks for having me.
Well, I'm glad to have you and your two owls there hanging out behind you there. You are in a band. We're going to talk about your band and how you actually let's talk about name your band, and then would you come up with a name first?
Well, I'm in a band called Bordered Car, and Bordered Car was formed in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, in the USA 40 years ago in 1981. There's nothing really magical about our name. We just were really looking for something that expressed what we were. Mm-hmm. And we were an 80s noise band, and we were just kicking things around, this and that. And Eric Lundy, the other founder of the band, came up with the name Bordered Car. And it's like, yep, that's us. That's a good explanation of what we were doing.
No, that's good. I think when you hear a name of something, you kind of go with it usually.
Yeah, it fit. It
feels
fit.
Right. I mean, I've been asked about the name of the show. I like laughing. I like monkeys. I like cheeseburgers, but the Laughing Monkey Cheeseburger Show would be ridiculous. So it's got to be Laughing Monkey Music. I think it's a cooking show. So you've been out 40 years. What were your first interest in the band? Like what were you listening to at the time of the formation of the band? Because you have it. We'll go talk about the sound, but I want to talk about what are your.
Well, when we took off in 1980, we were really influenced by a lot of what was going on in New York City. The Swans had just come out.
Nice.
Red Jules Baptist, Red Decade, the very early Sonic Youth. Mm-hmm. And myself and Eric Lundy went to a festival that was called New Music America. It was held in Chicago in 1981 in the Navy Pier. It was a multi-day thing. One of the days, Glenn Branca played with his guitar orchestra. It was about the time the Ascension album came out on Neutral. And to us, that was unbelievable that we could experience seeing Glenn Branca. So we saw Glenn Branca, fantastic. So of course, the next day we're back at the festival in Chicago, which was 90 miles from Milwaukee. And I think we saw John Hassell play, and John Cage was there. He had an exhibit that was a tugboat that you would go in, and that was the Cage piece. Well, Cage blasted Glenn Branca in the press. Heavy, heavy, like, if this is the kind of world Glenn, I paraphrase, if this is the kind of world Glenn Branca wants, I don't want any part of it. Really blasted Branca. So Eric and I are there on Navy Pier, and there's Glenn Branca sitting on a park bench. So we go up and sit down, we start talking to him about his music, telling him that we wanted to do this band, and he gave us advice. He encouraged us. He said, don't worry about it. You'll find a place to play. You'll find it, you know, you'll find a place to rehearse. Don't worry about it. So we were directly influenced by the, you know, rest in peace, the late Glenn Branca. So that's the thing we were into, that New York sound. We lived in an apartment together. We went to university together. The phone rang one day, and it was Jules Baptist from Red Decade looking for a gig. We were blown away. To us, it was like this artistic and musical world that was going on in New York, and London, and all that. It was like, hey, it wasn't strange to us. It wasn't like, oh, these are our idols. They were our idols, people we looked up to, but it was very accessible. We never got a Red Decade gig. And we came up in a time when there were lots of punk bands in Milwaukee, lots of hardcore bands, and we would play with those bands. So
has your sound changed at all? I mean, over the years?
Oh yeah. Very, very
much mellower and are like different.
Well, it's much different. I mean, in the course of these 40 years, I was counting up, I think there's been 20 different people that have been involved in the band, in big ways or small ways. Things change, times change, technology changes. Mm-hmm. When we started in 1981, I mean, it was a very underground culture. Cassette tapes were traded. There's a fellow who I really, I think is a great musician, Richard Fernecki. He had a band called FI. He's in a band called Volkakesh. And Richard was one of these tapers swapping these tapes. No internet, you know. So it was a different time. And it's, yeah, to answer your question. So yeah, things change, you know. We never had, we still don't really spend a lot of money on instruments. And, you know, I mean, it was always very as we went, you know.
Well, because the music is, and we'll see it afterwards. Actually, you're nice enough to make a nice video, really, really nice. Different than it usually is on the show. Usually you can put it in your car, kind of rock out to it or whatever, chill out. This music is a little different. It is, and I would say, you know, it's kind of a soundtrack. When you listen to it, you really need to kind of focus on it and kind of, you know, pack a lunch. You're not going to be popping in for one song. It's kind of something you have to absorb. And maybe go back two or three times, you know? It's definitely a little different than your normal chorus versus chorus, you know? It's very, very interesting. It's very enjoyable. It's just different. And the first time you'll be like, whoa, you know, it's just, you know, nothing you're going to hear on the radio. And you also have some videos on YouTube, obviously. What are some of the instruments you're playing in there? I mean, you actually use a lot of different things, too.
I use a variety of, currently, I play guitar. I have one of the new Behringer Wasp reproductions. The classic Wasp was a synthesizer, that very cheap English synthesizer in the 80s that White House, which was a very, you know, infamous noise industrial band, used. I use a sampler. I use these little cheap devices that are called wiretaps, and they're actually like loopers. Mm-hmm. And what they're really designed for is you have them in your rig, and when you're jamming and you find some riff you like, you're supposed to hit it and it keeps it for you. Well, of course, I use it as a way to keep, you know, many different sounds and textures and bits of the soundtrack. And I currently have five of these in my setup. So it's not just push one and, you know, here's this song, one sound. It's a variety of different things that mix. I have a couple little mixers, some noise makers, some contact mics, you know, for the, you know, live kind of setup.
How about songwriting? Like, how is it? Like, is it hard? Because, I mean, it's not the normal song structure.
Well, it's not normal song structure, but I would rest assured to the listeners that in our mind, or in my mind, or the composer's mind, these are specific songs. You can listen to us and go, oh man, those guys are just making noise. What is happening? And actually, to us, we probably have just played a succession in our half hour set at a local club or bar or whatever. We probably just played a succession of what was us was seven songs from our last 40 years. I mean, when we played in New York, in Los Angeles recently in 2019, the first time we played in Los Angeles in 33 years, we played songs from 1981 to songs that are current. But they're versions of songs and they're adaptations of songs. And we do songs that, a couple really old songs that I never sang to start with. And the lyrics are a little bit, we don't really know what the lyrics are. There's a few different versions of the lyrics, you know, because perhaps these songs have been done, where they say they were done in the 80s. Mm-hmm. And then the band went fallow in the 90s as far as, are doing anything. Although the band went on because there were lots of reissues. People cared about the band when we didn't. So then when we came back in 2006, we may be playing these songs that were originally in the 80s that is now turned into another version. Well, now it's 2021. We may play some of the same songs in a different version.
No,
I don't know if that answers the question.
No, it does. Well, you know what I'm saying? It's like, and the easy answer from the outsider, and I'm taking really an outside view on this, because I as I ask these questions, is because most songs you're like verse, chorus, it's really easy. And some bands are like, they go on tour, like regular structured songs go, I have to relearn my music every time I go on tour.
Sure.
You know, it'd be like, you know, kind of a close thing I can think of that I listen to all the time, be like a Zappa song. It kind of goes other places and there's so much going on to remember. There's a lot. So when your song doesn't have a full on structure, you got a lot. Well, I guess it's continuity. You know it that way. That's how you know it.
Right. We know that's
But it is a little different. So that's why I'm asking you. It's not the ordinary.
Oh, no, no, no. Process. It's not the usual songwriting process. Although there are, you know, songs about different experiences, things that happen. I mean, I do write lyrics, a lot of which are pretty much about things that happened to me, although it might not be obvious to the listener what we're referring to. Yeah. So it's, but there certainly are songs. There certainly is composition. There always, you know, has been. And as anything over 40 years, it's going to be fluid. I mean, we're not trying to reproduce. We may play songs that we can't, we wrote in 1981. We used to play a song called I Ate My Lunch and Left, which I swear was the first Boyd or Carr song we ever wrote. I know it, I think. So anyway, we used to play that because, you know, we were kind of reintroducing the band. We were playing out of town in Los Angeles to people that like knew the history of the band. And that's one of the interesting things about Boyd or Carr is it kind of has a life of its own. I mean, like, as I mentioned in the 90s, when I didn't care about it, it was all kind of in the vague. People were putting it, was, the albums were being reissued in Australia.
People
heard about it. People were interested. It's like, okay, that's cool.
That's real cool.
Things like that. A big thing that helped the band, I don't know, culturally, and I don't know if you're aware of this, is in the 80s, we were in the Ann Landers column. I don't know if you remember Ann Landers. She was a
Yeah, I do.
So yeah, we were in the Ann Landers column. My aunt who was in St. Louis called me because we had been in the, well, it started, it was funny. We were interviewed by the New York Times or the Wall Street Journal, correct? And the Wall Street Journal. And the article was about this new kind of music, junk rock, which was Eintrittsende Neubauten, SPK, stuff like that when that was taking off. So we were interviewed by the Wall Street Journal. Well, this is weird. Okay, we'll do that. So we talked to him. So some father in Rhode Island wrote Ann Landers after he read this article about junk rock. But apparently, and understandably, in the whole thing, the only name the guy could remember was Boyd or Carr. So all this horrible junk rock and all this stuff that kind of had been attributed to SBK and Eintrittsende Neubauten and blah, blah, blah. He kind of only got, you know, we kind of got credit.
Yeah.
So these are outside cultural forces that have always kind of been with us.
Yeah. Was he complaining? Was he like, Darian Landers, what am I going to do?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. It was disgusted father in Rhode Island. If this isn't the end of music as we know it, blah, 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 you know.
Well, that's the best review ever.
Yeah, it was great. And Ann replied like, don't worry about it, Pops. This is going to, you know, go away. No one's going to remember this. And of course, I read this a lot of times during our shows. And it's like a huge, it's like, maybe not, you know.
That's pretty funny because most people don't know Ann Landers anymore. I mean,
we it's this weird like thing that happened that Boyd or Carr instigated. So I don't think we're totally in control. I mean, not totally in control of it now, although I mean, it's my band. It's my.
What would you call yourself now? Was it junk rock? I've never really heard that term.
That was never really a pitch. It was just that one Wall Street.
I don't even think I've ever heard that term before. It's pretty funny. Actually.
Yeah, no, that was junk rock. Yeah, junk rock.
How do you classify to the new listener?
These days, I tend to think we're more, you know, experimental, avant-garde. Mm-hmm. I still go with the noise moniker. Times have changed. When we came out in the 80s, it was called industrial music because Throbbing Gristle put out their records on their own label called Industrial Records. And then there was noise with the Sonic Youth and then, you know, No Wave. But then what was it? By the 90s, industrial rock meant like, what, Nine Inch Nails?
Yeah.
So it's like, nah, we're not.
Came FDM, really. Yeah, kind of got really heavy and
yeah, which was
it went everywhere with that one too.
Right. So at that point, we really were like, whoa, well,
That's not you.
Not really. We're not industrial at all. It kind of took off in another way.
That's a video of Border Car of myself and Julian Rulli playing a few weeks ago in our basement in South Minneapolis. It's about a half hour. Julie plays synthesizers, a Moog, some other electronics. She plays a Dan Electro sitar, which is a kind of a weird guitar-ish instrument. I play guitar, do vocals, electronics, and pre-recorded sounds, and some keyboards. The set that we're going to play, that's pretty much our typical kind of set that we've been doing lately. Touches on some old songs, some new songs.
Open their ears, open their eyes, and open their minds. Kind of sit down and be committed. You know, if you're looking for the normal rock and roll, it's going to be a little different. You know,
right? You need to. You
might walk away going, "Oh, that's, I don't know." And you may need to come back again. You know, let it soak in. You know, I listened to it the first time. I watched the video and listened to it, and then I gave a little bit of space, and I went back and just listened to the music separately. You know, so it's a different experience. It's, you know, that's how I did it. So if it's something new to you, try to be open.
I would say that I would point out to the listeners that there's a lot of variety over this half hour performance. There's a lot of different things that are going to happen, a lot of different twists and turns sonically, instrumentally, texturally. So you do need to like kind of follow it. It's going to change. Yeah, maybe parts of it that are very weird or parts that you don't like. And there's some things that are a little heavy, that are a little noisy. We're living in a pretty, you know, pretty dark, pretty heavy time.
Well, I hope people enjoy the video. So sit down and relax and check it out.
Yeah, enjoy. Make a joyful noise. Thank you very much. Thanks for listening and your interest.
Hey, yo.
It's January 16th, 2021. This is a little live video. We're making a Border Car for the Laughing Monkey podcast.
Ten, nine, eight, seven, six, five, four, three, two, one.
I remember getting in the car with Tex and
Tex Watson
and my other two co-defendants.
I'm out here on the highway. Big train.
And before I ever got in the car.
I'm out there on the highway. I'm out there on the highway. Sure, I'm out there on the highway. I'm out there on the highway.
Let me ask you a question.
Church Road. It's from our Venice Beach cassette. This song named after a rundown house on Morton Street in Germantown. To my Rava release. It's called The Devil's Headquarters. Which is my beloved Julie. One, two, three. Sinner nor is saints. Well, there's a long fractured tale she has to tell you. I think I took away from the whole situation. Don't lie to me, motherfucker. I'm gonna blast out of balance. kisses and a few bull's eyes. I'm fixing to go down to the rehearsal room. I'm gonna pop my revenge against those motherfuckers that brought this down. Quietly moving them and packing in a box. Understanding completely. I do not exist. I do not exist. I do not exist. I do not exist. Now with dawn, waddling tiny balls of shit piled up on the edge of Blackpaw Road. We're all in perfect harmony. We are ethic of examination and public discussion. We're dead horse. Dead horse. Dead horse. Start.
Thank you.
Tore out his eyes. He 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 tore out his eyes. Go with Tex and do exactly what he says.
This is my handiwork, leading to the distortion of reality that has become too complex for me to restore, losing sight of the reality that surrounds me.
Go with text and do exactly what he says.
Unable to retain these images of the fractured reality, the blood arching, the fractured reflection that his life has become.
He tore out his eyes. That was from our 1985, our first vinyl. It was a split vinyl with FI. Prior to that was the title track of the 1983 cassette called The Ghost Shirt. It's called Oceans Away. It's from Venice Beach.
Your car arm.
boy.
Dirt. Car. Boy.
Dirt. Car. Boy.
Dirt. Car.
Boy.
Dirt. Thank you.
Car. Boy.
Dirt. Car.
Boy. Dirt. Car. Boy.
Dirt. Car.
Boy. Dirt. Car. Boy.